talk that I'm going to give you is based on a couple of chapters in my book, Perfect Mechanics, Instrument Makers of the Royal Society of London in the 18th Century. Interesting group of men who in their day were acknowledged to be extremely important and extremely capable. Now, the story I'm going to tell you tonight, like any invention of anything very important, is was a dispute over who actually invented it, and that story is really quite fascinating. But the story of the achromatic lens and its invention spans more than a century, and it starts really with Isaac Newton, because not only did he notice, of course, what was well known, that the a single curved lens would focus light to a point, but there'd be a smear of colour called chromatic aberration. He did a series of experiments that he thought demonstrated that it was impossible under any circumstances to get rid of that colour, right? So it wasn't just that the single lens, but any combination of lenses would be unable to remove the aberration. So he had an experiment in the optics, and so if you can think of it like this, with this prism, right, you get the prism, the white light comes in, and then you get the colour opening up. So it's an image everyone's familiar with, if only from Pink Floyd, Dark Side. So no, you still play the music here, right, so you can never get away from Pink Floyd. So the fact that light is bent, you can call that the refractive power of the glass. And so think of a mean ray in the middle of all that light. So that's what we call the refractive power of the glass, its ability to bend the mean ray. But the width of the spectrum, right, how wide it is from the bluest through to the reddest, that's called the dispersive power of the glass. So those are the two words we're going to need tonight. Refractive power, the ability to bend light, and the dispersive power, which is also called differential refrangibility by Newton, that's the width of the spectrum. So he thought, well, okay, let's see if we can get rid of the colour. So the obvious way to get rid of the colour is to, you've got one prism like this, right? And then put one next to it like that, okay? Because if it's inverted, it's going to close the colour back down, right? It's going to close the spectrum back down. You're running it backwards. So he did a series of experiments, and he said, whatever I did, and he used standard glass of the day, crown glass, and then he used prisms filled with water that had a different refractive power. He said, whatever I did, whatever arrangements I did, if I got rid of the colour, right? There was no colour at the end of these two combinations with light going through them. White light in, get rid of the colour. White light out, that's great. But what do you think the problem was? What's the flaw with that setup?
No
light, the light doesn't get bent. So you've just got a straight line, right? The light just goes through. Beautifully white the whole way through, fabulous. Absolutely useless if you're trying to build a lens, right? Because for a lens you've got to bend light. So Newton said from that experiment that it was impossible to build a refractive lens that also removed the colour completely. And I just read it out. It's always good to read Newton. This is from the 1704 Optics. Newton is, you know, one of these towering, colossal minds of our civilization. And this is what he said. I found, moreover, that when light goes out of air through several contiguous refracting mediums, that's the arrangements of different prisms, as through water and glass, and thence goes out again into air, whether the refracting superficies be parallel or inclined to one another, that light, as often as by contrary refractions to so corrected, that it emergeth in lines parallel to those in which it was incident, and continues ever after to be white. Okay? So he says, we're stuffed. Right? And of course, if you you walk into the Royal Society today, you go into their library, it's a beautiful library, and there's this tiny little reflecting telescope. That's Newton's telescope. It's the first reflecting telescope in the world. It's still there, you can go look at it. It might actually, I think they say it's original, but it's just a tiny little thing. And he said, boy, have I got a deal for you. Not only is it impossible to correct refracting telescopes, I have invented the future, the reflector, the reflecting telescope. And of course, he's absolutely right. It's a dramatic and important technological development. And in fact, it was what announced to the world was this astonishing technical discovery. And so as a result of the brilliance of Newton and his authority, and as a result of the utility of the reflecting telescope, his word was taken as law. He was the greatest scientist of his era, or the greatest natural philosopher of his era. He was a meticulous and careful experimenter. The one I just read out to you and described to you, he did it very, very carefully. And, rather remarkably, nobody repeated it for nearly a century. Okay, so that's the stage set. In the 1660s, Newton says, you can't improve the refractors, let's go down the reflector route. And then he gave some more experimental evidence in the optics in 1704. So that's it, right? Now, can anyone think of a lens that would appear in biology, in humanity, that would appear to remove chromatic aberration? To there's no coloured fringes when it operates.
Your eye.
Sorry?
Your eye.
Yeah. So in the 1740s, Euler, the great German mathematician, said, well, hang on a minute. Our eye appears to be achromatic. We don't walk around seeing coloured fringes on everything. Surely we just need to build a lens that looks like the eye. And in fact, if he'd read his Newton carefully, he wouldn't have said that, but that's what he says. It's obviously got to be the case. Now, what's the flaw with that argument?
The eye doesn't really magnify.
That's one issue. But also, is the eye actually achromatic?
We don't know.
No, it's but it's sampled differently from an image from a telescope.
Yeah. So there's some trickery going on in the retina in our brain that cleans up this messy problem. And so if you were to just copy the eye, as Euler had suggested, you couldn't make a refractive lens, right? So you've got the little crystalline lens, and you've got the vitreous humor around it. Those two things combined, Euler thought, was an analogy for the eye. Nevertheless, he published a paper saying, no, Newton has to be wrong. And in response to this, the English scientists rose up and were outraged that anyone would oppose the word of the great Sir Isaac Newton. The first person to do this was James Short, the most eminent maker of reflecting telescopes in London at the time. And the second man who popped up to say, no, it's ridiculous, was a chap called John Dolland. And John was a silk weaver in London and Spitalfields, and he had, we're not quite sure how, became self-taught in optics and had created an optical business in the city of London. And he was a member of the Guild of the Spectacle Makers, the opticians, sorry. And even Dolland didn't repeat the experiment, right? He said, I'm paraphrasing him here, that which Sir Isaac Newton has demonstrated to be true is clearly the case, and it is very odd that anyone would question the word of Sir Isaac Newton. Now, to us, this seems incredible. Why didn't someone just go and repeat the experiment, right? No one did. It's a shame that no one repeated it, because it turns out that Newton is wrong. It's one of the few examples of where the great man made a mistake, and it was quite an interesting one. So then a Swedish astronomer called Samuel Klingensterner weighed in, and he wrote back to Dolan and said, hang on a minute, I think there's something not quite right about Newton's experiment 8. Why don't you repeat it? Why don't you go and make further experiments? So Dolan did. And what he did was he now had a new kind of glass in England called lead glass or flint glass. Right? So you've got two kinds of glass, the standard bottle or crown glass, and then the flint glass with the more lead in it. So you've got two different kinds of glass. And he just repeated Newton's experiments, but not with the prism filled with water. He had one with the standard crown and then one the inverted with the flint. And what he discovered when he ran that experiment was that the flint glass had a higher dispersive power than the crown glass. So what does that mean? That means that for a less amount of refractive power than the crown glass, it would have the same amount of dispersive power that the crown glass had. So that then meant that when you ran the light through, the smaller flint prism could close down all the colour, but it didn't close down all the bending of the mean ray. So at the end of it all, you had white light goes in, the prism colours are closed down, and you get bending. Right? You've got your silver lens. You now, and this was the first time anyone had demonstrated that you could make a refracting doublet that was reasonably free of colour. And of course, an absolute sensation. People didn't dwell too much in England on the fact that Newton was wrong, because this was just embarrassing for national honour. But how could something like this come about? Well, I think there's some interesting pieces to the story. Firstly, in a culture that did not overturn authoritative figures very easily or very happily, that's part of the story. But I think the other part of the story is the community of opticians who had grown up using different kinds of glass. And so it's the materiality that's very, very important. And the thing that would have been so disturbing to Euler, the greatest mathematician of the 18th century, and so disturbing to Newton in the 17th century, was that from the refractive power, you could not then theoretically predict how wide the spectrum would be. They were very upset about that. They felt there ought to be a mathematical theory such that once you've measured the mean ray, you could just tell how wide the spectrum was going to be. And in fact, it was because they had that thought in their minds, they were almost unable to conceive of the possibility of something having the same kind of refractive power, but different dispersive power, different ability to open up the whole spectrum of colour. So that's one example, I think, of where you can be a very profound theoretician, but sometimes nature gets in the way, and it turns out that there is no a priori theoretical calculation that will give you the dispersive power of the piece of glass once you measure its real refractive power. So the man that worked with his hands, the man that understood the different powers of glass, was the man who stuck the two bits together. And so, rather remarkably, for a man who owned a shop, I think it was on the Strand, a shopkeeper, you'd go and walk in there and buy a telescope from John and his son Peter Dolan, was given the top prize of the Royal Society in 1758, the Cuppy Medal, and his paper was published. Crucially, the paper is published, and it establishes that John Dolan did the experiment, and it establishes the possibility of making achromatic doublets. And if you didn't believe the paper, you could walk into the shop and look down the telescope, or look through the telescope and see the superiority of it all. So, John then was elected to the Royal Society, which is pretty unusual, but really rather fascinating that some guy runs a shop can also be an eminent scientist. And then he died in 1761. And had the story stopped there, perhaps, well, I wouldn't have anything more to tell you, but it gets a lot more interesting. Because like most inventions, people compete for the credit of who actually invented the lens. And the reason why this story is so fascinating is because the son, Peter Dolan, was commercially very clever, very aggressive, and he set off the whole series of patent lawsuits that revealed a very, very interesting state of optical affairs in London in the 1760s. Okay, so we've got the patent. John Dolan enrolled the patent, I think it was in about 1758. And if you go read it, it's very simple. It basically sort of says what I've said, and it's very, very vague thereafter. There are no diagrams. There's no discussion about prior art. Anything that you'd expect from modern patents just did not exist in the 1750s in London. You just registered the thing, and if people infringed, you thought about taking it to court, and then most of the time you probably didn't bother because it was too expensive. Anyway, Peter took all the opticians in London who were making achromatic lenses, right? The Dolans in John's lifetime, the fathers, hadn't really done anything about the other opticians that were making the lenses. So let's take a step back and think about the optical community. The idea of patents or monopolies is anathema to a guild, right? If you're a member of a guild, you share the knowledge with your other guild members, you have apprentices, you teach them the trade, you're a group. And innovation, if it occurs, is to be shared amongst everybody. It's a very sort of communitarian approach to how you do things. And so there's absolutely nothing unusual about one guy tweaking something, making it a little bit differently, and then everyone else copying him and, you know, free for all. Completely standard practice. Very different to the way we think of things today. However, things were changing in the second half of the 18th century in England. The notion of guilds was on the way out and being replaced by much more competitive individualism, and replaced with what we now call intellectual property. It was starting to come into being. By the end of the century, you have some very famous patents, most noticeably with James Watt and his condensing steam engine. So, there had been a crucial change with Peter Dolan's practice. He'd been able to manufacture the lenses more cheaply, more quickly, and he figured out he could satisfy the whole market. And he decided to put all the rest of the guys out of business by taking them to court. And the reason it's so fascinating is we have a lot of the legal documents that tell us about this patent trial. And of course the plot starts to thicken. When John Dolan had enrolled the patent, he had sold half of it to another optician called Watkins. Dolan, I don't think, had enough capital to pay for the costs of enrolling the patent and the associated legal fees. So he got into partnership with Mr. Watkins. So very definitely Mr. Watkins knew how to make achromatic lenses, right? Because he was a partner with John and Peter Dolan. So they're making lenses from 1758 through to 61. And then Peter unleashed the lawyers on Mr. Watkins, who had sold his half share of the patent back to Peter and kept on making the lenses, right? Now, we chuckle a bit, right? By his standards, by the standards of the optician's company, that's just standard behaviour. Everyone shares, and, you know, just there's plenty of market for all the master opticians. So in the trial, Peter Dolan's lawyers asked Mr. Watkins, well, who had claimed that he thought the patent was worthless and should not be enforced because it's vague, and besides, John Dolan had copied someone. I'll come to that in a minute. Peter Dolan's lawyer said to him, well, hang on a minute, why did you sell it for £200 if you thought it was worthless? And he said, well, I did that because I didn't think it had a very good chance of being upheld in the courts. So the objection that the patent was vague, the courts took no notice of that. The objection that everyone else was doing it anyway, so why should Peter Dolan be the only one to do it, they took no notice of that. And very interestingly, the final claim that all the defendants brought, that somebody else had invented the lens before John Dolan, they also ignored. And the reason for this was this chap was a very unusual character. His name was Chestermore Hall. He was a lawyer in Essex, about whom virtually nothing else is known. And there's not a single manuscript or a single published document that outlines his thinking or his experiments or his work in this area. Nonetheless, the opticians, while being sued, told the following story. Before Mr. Dolan brought his lens to market, Mr. Hall asked two different opticians to make each part of the doublet. It's a concave and a convex doublet lens. And they were a bit lazy or incompetent, so they jobbed it out to the same guy. This is the story. I'm not making this up. He then made the two bits, and he put them together, and oh my gosh, I've got an acrobatic lens on my hands. And then he told everyone else, and apparently, you know, that's how the achromatic lens was invented. The main flaw with this story is twofold. Firstly, there's absolutely no evidence of any manuscript activity or any published activity or any experiments of Mr. Hall, whoever he was. All we have are a couple of signatures, like Shakespeare, right? All we've got is Shakespeare, I think, is his will, isn't it? And a couple of signatures, it's from a scrap of manuscript, but better evidence of his existence. And so there was no evidence to be produced in court. Mr. Hall never turned up to court because he wasn't being sued, so he couldn't be forced to turn up. And most crucially, there wasn't a single telescope that predated Dolan's of 1758 that had been available for sale. And in a very famous judgment, Lord Mansfield ruled that it mattered not if a man invented something but kept it locked up in his cabinet and hid it away from the public. What did matter was the man who first brought it to the public in a useful format. So every single one of the patent cases was thrown out, and Peter Dolan got to control the trade, to the complete outrage of all the opticians. And he went on to dominate. So if you are looking in observatories that have got refractors from really 1760 to about 1800, they're nearly all Dolan's. Because they came to dominate the trade, and also because of the English dominated the production of the flint glass. Remember that bit? That's the one, the very powerful bit that has a very high dispersive power. And so then you might think, oh well, complete triumph to the Dolans. They've got the Cuppy Medal, John's FRS. If everyone buys their telescopes, they're right, go right around the world. They won all the patent cases. You know, what more is there? But then, very extraordinary, a landmine went off in 1789, right at the end of the story, from John Dolan's son-in-law, the great Jesse Ramsden. And he's the maker of theodolites and divided instruments, a very, very great instrument. Really the last of the great instrument makers in the 18th century to also Society. And he published a little article in a journal claiming, reminding people about the lawsuit and saying that actually, yes, Hall was the first inventor. And so to this day, you can go to museums and you can go just in one, Jena itself, where this telescope was made, and the same story is told that actually Hall was the first inventor. Now, could he have made the first achromatic lens? It's not impossible. But what is rather extraordinary is that he kept it to himself. Now, why might he have kept it to himself? This is all speculation, by the way, because we have no documentary evidence. We have no idea what actually happened. Why might he have kept it to himself? Well, firstly, he didn't care about making any money out of it. He wasn't a professional optician. Secondly, he might have been terrified of trying to go against Isaac Newton. It was a very heavy weight of authority for anyone to make any claim as to why Newton was wrong. But for So either he really did keep it truly secret, or in fact, it's a fabrication by these desperate opticians as they're about to have the whole trade taken away from them. We don't really know what the story is there. So why was Newton wrong? I mean, this is one of the smartest guys who's ever lived, right? Peter Dolan tried to answer this as to why this may have been the case. And he just said, well, I think it was just bad luck. And there's some truth to that. It turns out that the glass prisms that Newton made filled with water that he was balancing against the solid glass ones had pretty much the same dispersive power as the glass. So walking down that path, he wasn't going to stumble on a substance with a very different dispersive power, a very different ability to open up the prism. But counterbalancing that is, I think, in a way, you know, that reflecting telescope was his baby. That's what made him famous. And, you know, I think that kind of confirmatory bias, you know, he didn't, I don't think he really wanted the refractor to work. So that's the story by which we got achromatic refractors. The nuts and bolts and the details are much more complex. There are people who are very good at looking at these original lenses and talking about how they actually got made, how they got ground, how they got measured up. And the final thing I do want to talk about is the glass, because I think one thing we don't perhaps fully realise in this time period is just the amazing thoughtfulness and understanding that the instrument makers had for their materials. And the key to the Dolan doublet was measuring that dispersive power. You had to be able to measure it. And Dolan, that would appear, I write about it in my book, created a kind of a variable prism that enabled him to measure the dispersive power of every single piece of glass that they were using in their lenses. Because again, you know, we're so spoiled today. We can pull a piece of glass off the shelf or order it, and it will be flawless, right? It will have exactly the refractive and dispersive power the manufacturer tells you that it has. It won't have any bubbles in it, it won't have any striations in it, that it will be completely clean. Back then, the glass was in this big pot, it cooled down, you got bits out, some of it was terrible, some of it was usable, but you didn't know what its refractive dispersive power was a priori, right? You couldn't dial it up by measuring in various amounts of silicon and making glass. You had to measure each piece. And that, I think, was one of the keys to the success of the Dolans and instrument makers generally. It was a very deep understanding of the materials they work with. And so grasping that, they were able to build devices that took advantage of that materiality in ways that were very, very powerful. And of course, we live with this heritage today. We're very accustomed now to having materials that are very precisely delineated and behave the way in which we expect them to behave. But it really only got going, I think, in the second half of the 18th century, and was an important part of the Industrial Revolution, which we're still living with today. So there you have it. It took over 100 years. Almost 100 years from the Newton's reflector. If you return to your point, Bill, about Galileo, was that 1608 or something, or 1610? It's nearly 150 years from the first refractor to an achromatic refractor. And now, of course, I'm sure you can buy them for, I don't know, 10 cents or something. You know, they're not a very good one, but, you know, and the ones that go in our phones. I mean, well, someone was saying, your backup camera, right? You know, it's in your bumper. I mean, it's not that big. That's extraordinary. But we live within that inheritance that men like John Dolan created for us. So thank you very much.
questions from the audience for Richard?
When did the patents expire?
They were 14 years. So I think they were enrolled in 1758. So he had a run through the whole 60s. Yeah, and by the time they expired in 1772, they were just completely dominant. I mean, other makers came in and figured out how to make them. I mean, you just pull them apart and copy them. But you actually, the reverse engineering doesn't work unless you know how to measure the properties of the glass. And in fact, Dollons were pulled apart right around Europe. And Europe, especially the French, were particularly aggravated. They couldn't replicate them. Because the French way of things was much more geometrical. So they thought, if you get the geometry right, you're home. Well, that's actually only half. But you have to get the geometry right, of course, for the optics. But if you don't know the properties of the glass and measure each piece, then it's pointless. You can't get anywhere. That's a great question. Yes, but they just dominated until the Germans came through in the early 19th century. Yeah.
Regarding Newton, he chose water filled bags, as it's called. Where's the kind of glass that would have actually produced the effect that Dollond found actually available at the time Newton was experimenting? And did he just not go down the road? Or was it even that reliable glass at that time just wasn't available to?
Well, there was certainly lead based crystal glass. It's not clear why. I mean, in his mind, I think glass was glass. And so he just took some and he just kept going with the same glass. I think you could have found some glass that had a different dispersive power. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But
a lot of modern large achromatics, which are astonishingly expensive, are made of the second elements made of quartz.
Okay. Okay.
Not an amorphous glass as such, just cut from crystalline quartz.
Which is
a totally different story, but that's a recent development, and they're expensive, but they're exceptional lenses, absolutely exceptional.
Yeah. So what's the advantage there? Is the clarity of it?
The predictability and uniformity of the crystalline lens. But it just produces a more accurate achromatic.
Yeah.
So if you want to buy a really expensive refractor, that's what they've got in it.
The other thing is the modern optician has another degree of freedom because of what are called ED glasses that are similar to calcium fluoride, which isn't really a glass at all, but it has quite different dispersive properties to either crown or flint glass. And combining those three types of glass, you can get basically all the colours coming to focus. Like those type of lenses called apochromatic lenses. And they're very expensive. a few members
do. Dollons were very expensive. There's records of, I mean, they were bought by princes and kings throughout Europe. A good one in the 1770s would have cost you about between 50 and 100 pounds. And that's when, you know, a farm labourer earned 15 pounds a year. I mean, room and board possibly as well. Or a servant would have been on 20 pounds a year. A top builder, a top carpenter, a top tradesman, 50 to 100 pounds. So it was. They were really, really expensive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, by the standards of the day. So yeah, interesting.
Mm-hmm. That's why most amateurs probably stick with reflectors even today. Because a good quality refractor is still an expensive beast for the aperture you get.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, so
how wealthy does Peter end up? I mean.
He was a substantial citizen, you know. Interestingly, the opticians eventually made peace with him. I think basically once the patent expired, everything settled down. And so I don't know if he got the actual top of the guild, but interestingly, he was never made fellow of the Royal Society. The Royal Society was appalled by his behaviour. They regarded him as a crass commercial person, and they wouldn't have anything to do with him. Yeah. But no, and in fact, and maybe it's finally gone, but even in the 1990s, there was a firm called Dollond and Acheson in England which sold spectacles, and it was descended from that firm. So they flourished right through the 19th century. Yeah.
Interesting.
And on between.
The same sort of dispersion properties with different liquids, because I mean, if Newton had used water and alcohol, water and some other thing, it would have different properties.
I might want to say theoretically yes, but I don't actually know. I can't answer that question. It sounds plausible though, doesn't it? Given that you've got different glasses have different dispersive properties.
Yeah.
I don't know what liquids he would have had at his command, but you know, alcohol probably wouldn't make much difference. Maybe some of the oils, but then you kind of defeat the purpose of the lens of the oil soaks up so much. But he certainly didn't try the different liquids, he just popped water into that. It's a very interesting case study of how an experiment cannot be as complete as it looks. It's an odd blind spot with Newton, because normally he's a very meticulous guy. I mean, very, very brilliant, of course. It's just an odd mistake. Newton scholars don't really like talking about it. I get in trouble when I bring it up.
I thought that that's his mistake or deliberate mistake or whatever focusing on the reflective telescope is responsible for all serious telescopes. in terms of like astronomical telescopes, they're all reflective. All these telescopes are reflective. So
absolutely.
He was right in the sense any reflective telescope is in many ways superior fundamental technology. You're always chasing solutions to all the problems with lens telescopes with refractors, whereas reflectors are the real sort of, for anything large, reflectors are the superior solution anyway.
That's right, and that's why it's so remarkable to look at the first reflector. Oh, I'm not joking, it's that big. It's just unbelievable. Look at them. Wow, that's where it all started. What's so cool about science really is that it has a history, right? And things start. And you sort of say, wow, how did that happen? And why did it happen there and not somewhere else? And there's really fascinating questions about the history of science and we're the heirs to all these incredible developments. And it just starts with something really tiny and just keeps going. Telescopes are always at the cutting edge of technology. It's just fascinating. Astronomers are very demanding. And it's good that they are, because that's where the great discoveries come from.
Hey, thank you. I've got another question from Nubbin.
Two comments from you. You didn't do a great job on alchemy.
Newton was,
obsessed with alchemy. Of course, because he was interested in what were the powers of nature, and chemistry is really hard. Physics is easy. celestial mechanics is pretty straightforward compared to trying to figure out how the hell chemistry works. And physics and mechanics were very well developed by 1800, whereas chemistry was only just getting started. I mean, they couldn't even decide whether chemistry was just about matter or whether it was about atoms. I mean, they didn't really resolve that until late 19th century. So, I mean, I say that facetiously, but as you go up through the sciences, they're more and more difficult to do at a profound theoretical level. So you have to develop methods and theories that work at that level. And so Newton, where chemistry was at that point, he just didn't have the capacity to kind of talk about it in a way that turns out to be very productive. He's good though. I mean, you look at him talking about capillary action and stuff. It's really interesting. I mean, you can see he knows there's some power down there that's running the show, and he really wants to understand it. And he knows it's completely different from gravity, but they just don't have the tools to get on top of molecular action. I mean, you've got so much more has to happen, but you can see he wants to understand things. Alchemy, we're not so sympathetic to it, but it was their way of trying to understand this realm of activity of nature that is hard to grasp.
Well, the comment was going to be, I visited a museum in Florence, the Museum of the History of Science.
Yes.
And there's one of Galileo's original lenses.
Yeah.
But it's broken.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and we were sort of looking at it and musing on the moment that it became broken, and wondering if the person who broke it understood the gravitas of what they just said.
Incredible. Sort
of pictured the cleaner dusting it.
No, that's a shock.
But the great museum, if you're ever in Florence,
Christ, you know.
Yes, I've been
there.
No, superb. I'm a sucker for history science museum.
Yeah, I was kind of shocked to hear that Joseph Fraunhofer used to deliberately make perfect achromatic lenses and then cut them in half to turn them into heliometers, which he used as a method of measuring angular separation of stars, although it's called a heliometer because originally they were measuring the angular diameter of the sun, so that during the course of the year, of course, as the Earth is closer and further away from the sun, being in an elliptical orbit, if they could measure the angular diameter very accurately, they could get a measurement of the ellipticity of the Earth's orbit to high accuracy. And the same instrument was actually used to measure parallax of stars by Bessel, so it's quite interesting.
Cool. Very cool. Anything else?
We have it on good authority that Newton was not hit on the head by an apple.
Yes. Although it's an early one, it first appears in, not exactly hit on the head, but that he saw an apple fall. This was his, not his son in law, because he never married, but I can't remember who the guy was, but a friend of the family sort of person writing the story in this, mm-hmm. just after he died, I think, or maybe just before he died. And I mean, that part of the story is plausible, that he did see the apple fall, and he thought, gosh, you know, what else is falling towards the Earth? Oh, maybe the moon. So, yeah. No, but I don't think
And any other questions? In that case, we'll adjourn for supper. But before we do that, as usual, we'd like to thank our speaker with a small gift.
Oh, lovely. Thanks very much.